Hello, dear students. We will be going to the next topic in the centrifugal pump today. That is work done by the impeller, heads and efficiencies of the centrifugal pump. So it is in the module 5. Let's go to a small recapitulation of the previous class, a quick review of the previous class, what we have done now. So we were discussing on the working principle of centrifugal pump in the last class. So for starting up the centrifugal pump, priming is required. Priming is nothing but filling up of the liquid in the suction pipe, volute casing of the pump, delivery pipe up to the delivery valve. Start of the pump shall be done through a prime mover. Generally, electric motors will be used as the prime mover, and the delivery valve is closed before the start of the water to flow through the volute chamber. Now allow the impeller to gain the normal speed. After the impeller gains the normal speed, the liquid enters the pump casing through the suction pipe and the impeller eye, and velocity energy is imparted to the liquid by means of centrifugal force produced by the rotation of the impeller, and the liquid is radially pushed out towards the impeller of the periphery. Now this is the thick duct. The water enters through the eye. The suction pipe is connected to the eye of the impeller. Now liquid gains the velocity energy radially, and radially moves due to the centrifugal force. Because of the centrifugal force, the water moves towards the periphery. The velocity energy will also be gained, as well as the pressure energy will also be gained now. So in the volute chamber, as well as you may have in some cases the guide vanes will also be there, then it may be called a diffuser. Here the velocity energy will be converted into the pressure energy, and maximum pressure energy will be created when it comes out of the volute chamber, and the water will be delivered to the delivery pipe. Now liquid enters the impeller, the second case now. That is the second stage. The third stage is velocity energy of the liquid is converted into pressure energy in the volute casing, because it may be of increasing diameter. Regular volute casing, we have seen different types of volute casing. In the diffuser casing, you may have a guide vanes, which reduces the velocity, and the gain in the pressure energy will take place, and the water will be discharged through the delivery pipe. That's what it is happens now. So that's what we have written now. Velocity energy of the liquid is converted into pressure energy by directing it to the expanding volute design casing or volute type of centrifugal pump or diffuser in the turbine pump. What is turbine pump? We have told it is nothing but the diffusers will be there, guide vanes will be there, which is responsible for the reduction in the velocity and improvement in the pressure energy. Now so afterwards, the delivery, when the normal speed occurs, the impeller speed occurs, the delivery valve is opened simultaneously. Now from the casing, the liquid passes into the pipe and lifted to the required height and discharged from the outlet to the upper end of the delivery end, where it is to be delivered now. When the pump is to be stopped, the last stage, the delivery valve shall be closed so that there should be sufficient quantity of water, or water should not be discharged from the outlet end or the delivery end of the pipe towards the pump. This is one reason. The second reason is, second time when the pump is started, priming is essential, we know it now. So a foot valve will be there at the end of the suction pipe, which takes care that the water will not move towards the sump. And if the delivery valve is closed, the water, the leftover water will be there up to delivery pump, delivery valve, so that when we start the pump for the next time, there will be there is no necessity of priming. For that purpose, delivery valve is to be closed so that the water will be retained up to delivery valve, and hence it makes it possible to start the pump without priming, unless the foot valve is not properly working. If the foot valve is properly working, there is no essentiality of priming again the pump now. That's how the working of the pump is being discussed in the previous class now. Now we shall go into finding an expression for the work done from the pump now. It is very much similar to what we have done for the turbine now. In case of centrifugal pump, work will be done by the impeller on the water. That you should know it now. The impeller will do work on the water, and hence it is lifted to a higher elevation. Expression for the work done by the impeller on the work. Impeller on the water will be determined by drawing the velocity triangle as we do it in the turbines. The liquid enters the impeller at the center and leaves at the outer periphery, that we know it now. That means liquid enters from the center now and it leaves at the periphery. So the type of flow in the case of centrifugal pump, generally it will be radial. In most of the case, it will be radial now. When the flow is radial, the absolute velocity will be in the same direction now. Therefore, we will not be having the virl velocity. The virl component will be zero. That is, VW1 will be zero now. So you will be having only the horizontal component of V1. That we call it as VF1. V1 will be equal to VF1. We will not be having the virl component. Only the vertical component will be there. The horizontal component is zero in this case now. So here, if the rotation is in this direction now, the rotation of the pump is in this direction. If we draw the tangent for this, then the component of the rotation will be U1. The component of the rotation component is U1. VR1 is the relative velocity component. That is nothing but V1 minus of U1. That you know it now. That we represent like that now. Vectorial representation of V1 minus of U1 is VR1 now. So we will not be having virl component. We will be having only the component of absolute component V1. That will be equal to VF1 now. Now here you will be having VR2. VR2 will be there. V2 will be the absolute velocity component at the exit. V2 will be the absolute velocity component at exit now. The component of V2 in the x direction is VW2, that is the velocity of virl. The component in the horizontal, in the vertical direction, will be equal to VF2, because V2 is in this direction. V2 is in this direction. The components will be in these two directions. That we know it now. This is nothing but VW2, and this will be VF2. VW2, this is V2, VW2, VF2 now. U2 is the component, is the rotational component in the direction of X, in the direction of X now. Similarly, VR2 is the relative velocity at the exit. VR2 is the relative velocity at exit now. But here VW1 will be 0 because the flow is radial. The flow is radial. So the absolute velocity V1 will be equal to VF1. We will not be having any horizontal component. VW1 will be equal to 0 now. Okay. So this is what we have seen. Now, if D1 is the diameter, if R1 is the assumptions that we make while we are doing the derivation is, as we told, water enters through the impeller I, that is the center of the impeller, in radial direction. This is the first assumption now. Hence the velocity of release zero. Velocity of release zero. And the flow component Vf1 is equal to the absolute velocity. Vf1 will be equal to V1. That is the first assumption that we make now. No energy loss in the impeller due to friction and eddy formation. This is one day the assumption, but we will consider it in the later period now. No loss due to shock and any other entry. Entry loss, exit loss is not there, as well as friction loss in the impeller doesn't happen now. There is uniform velocity distribution in the narrow passage between the two adjacent veins. This also we are going to take care of in the next slides to come. We will look into it, all these things now. These things we will look into it now. The loss component, we discuss it in the next slides. There I will take care of all these things. In the assumption, there is no loss in between the impeller, or there is no friction loss, there is no eddy loss, or there is no entry or exit loss in between the impellers, it should be known to you now. Now, this is the, this one, as we know, R1 is the radius now, R1 is the internal radius now, R2 is the external radius of the impeller now. So, naturally, D1 will be diameter we are considering, and D2 will be the diameter at the exit. Okay, so omega is the angular velocity because the rotation is happening here. It is the angular velocity will be there now. The rotation of the impeller is going to happen. The angular velocity is going to come into picture now. So omega is equal to 2 pi n by 60 now. And U1 is the tangential velocity of the impeller at the inlet. What is this tangential velocity? This is nothing but this we have seen now. This is the tangential, we have drawn tangent to this. The component of this one is U1. The component of U2 we have written like this. You just, it is the tangential velocity. It is not the velocity in this direction. The velocity in this direction we have not written. We have called it as U1. U1 is equal to pi d n by 60, pi d1 n by 60, where d1 is equal to 2 times r1. If you write, then it will become, as we call 2 pi n by 60 as omega, it is nothing but omega r1. U1 is equal to omega r1 now. So we are converting the angular velocity into tangential velocity component now. So similarly, U2 is equal to omega into R2 now. D2 is equal to R2 by 2, that we know it. That is the diameter of the impeller at the outlet now. V1 is the absolute velocity at inlet. VW1 is the velocity of wheel at inlet. That is equal to VW1 is equal to 0 for the derivation. But in the next slides, we will consider that also in the at the end of the derivation, we will consider those things also. If it is not radial, what is that? We have to look at it. We are going to consider it at the end of this derivation now. VR1 is the relative velocity at inlet. Vf1 is the velocity of flow at inlet. This is very much similar to what we do it in our turbine now. Alpha is the angle made by the absolute velocity V1 at the inlet with the direction of motion of vane. The same thing what we were discussing in the turbine is true here also. Theta is the angle made by the relative velocity at the inlet. These things we know it now. Alpha is the angle made. This is the alpha. This is theta now. This is theta. So alpha is called as the angle made by the absolute velocity V1 at the inlet with the direction of motion of vane. With the direction of motion of vane, what is that? That is alpha. Theta is the angle made by the relative velocity VR1 at the inlet with the direction of motion of vane. This is the theta now. This is theta. Angle made with reference to direction of motion of vane. The direction of motion of vane is this one now. So this is theta. Therefore, this will be theta now. Okay. So, shall be understood here now. Now, here, phi is the corresponding values. Phi are the corresponding values at the V2, VW2, VR2, VF2, beta. The same thing with reference to exit now. With reference to exit, beta, phi, as well as VF2, VW2, V2, they are all for the exit now. So these things what we have discussed in turbine holds good here also now. Now, as we do the revision in the turbine, it is also true here also. Work done is equal to torque into angular velocity now. Angular velocity. Okay. So there we are taking it a force into distance or force into velocity we were taking, not Fx into u we were taking. Here it is torque into angular velocity because it is the motion along a circle now. So what is torque? Torque is nothing but change in angular momentum. Change in angular momentum. What is angular momentum? Angular momentum is equal to momentum into radius. Momentum into radius is called as the angular momentum now. Now, momentum is equal to mass into velocity. Momentum is equal to mass into velocity. These things you know it already now. So now, so here, momentum, mass of water striking per second is equal to rho a v1. It is nothing but the mass what is striking per second, as we do it in the previous rho q, rho into q, what we are saying, the same thing is true here also. Momentum of water striking the vane in tangential direction, that is nothing but what? In this direction, in the x direction. Here Vw1 is equal to 0, therefore momentum is equal to 0. Momentum of water striking the vane in tangential direction at inlet is equal to 0. So at outlet it is equal to rho a v1 into Vw2. Rho a v1 into Vw2, that is the momentum of water striking the vane in the tangential direction at outlet now. So once again, angular momentum is equal to momentum into radius, 0 into R1. At inlet it is equal to 0. At outlet it will be equal to rho a V1 into Vw2 into R2 now. Okay. So angular momentum, what we discussed, angular momentum is equal to, here we have discussed now, angular momentum is equal to momentum into radius. The same thing, momentum into radius. Naturally, in the previous case, in this case, what has happened here is momentum of water striking the vane at tangential at inlet is equal to zero because the Vw2 is equal to zero now. Vw1 is equal to zero. At exit, Vw2 is there now. Therefore, momentum of water is there, rho a v1 into Vw2. Now, angular momentum, as we discussed, angular momentum is equal to momentum into radius. So, momentum into radius, that is nothing but rho a v1 into vw2 into r2 for the inlet, it is equal to 0 now. So, what is torque? What is this one we have discussed? Torque is equal to change in angular momentum. Torque is equal to change in angular momentum. That is nothing but what? Rho a v1 into vw2 into r2 minus of vw1 into r1 is equal to 0. Therefore, this is equal to 0. Inlet is 0. Inlet is 0. Therefore, outlet minus of inlet. Outlet torque minus of inlet torque. Inlet torque, that is the rate of torque. So, outlet torque is equal to rho a v1 into vw2 into r2. Whereas, inlet torque is equal to 0. Therefore, it will be the final torque is equal to rho a v1 into vw2 into r2 now. So, what is work done? We have discussed work done is equal to torque into angular velocity. So, you know now torque. You want to calculate this one now. So, angular velocity is nothing but omega. Angular velocity is equal to omega. So, rho a v1 into vw2 into r2 into omega will give you the work done per second. What is omega? U2 is equal to r2 into omega. That's what we discussed. U2 is equal to r2 into omega. We have told here now. U1 is equal to r1 into omega 1. U1 is equal to omega into R1 we have called. U2 is equal to omega into R2 we have called. Because U1 is equal to pi D1 N by 60. That is equal to omega R1 that has become now. U2 is equal to pi D2 into pi D2 N by 60. D2 is equal to pi R2 2 R2. That is equal to, so 2 pi N by 60. 2 pi N by 60. 2 pi N by 60. That is nothing but omega. Therefore, omega into R2 we have called. So, we can replace that U2 is equal to R2 into omega. We can call just I substitute the omega is equal to U2 by R2 now. This R2 and this R2 will get cancelled. You will be left with rho A V1 into VW2 into U2. What is A into V1? Area into velocity is nothing but what? That is nothing but Q. Q is equal to A into V1. Therefore, that I substituted as Q. Rho Q into VW2 into U2. Rho Q into VW2 into U2. That is the work done per second now. So, we know that the weight of the water striking per second is equal to M into G per second. Striking per second is equal to M 1 into G. That is nothing but rho into volume into G. Mass is equal to density, volume into density into g. What is volume per second? A into v1. Volume per second is A into v1. That is nothing but q. Therefore, rho into q into g is the weight of the water striking per second now. So, I can write here. Therefore, the work done per second is equal to equation A by equation B now. Work done per second per unit weight. Work done per second per unit weight. This is the weight of water. This is the work done per second. Work done per second per unit weight we are calling now. Per unit weight now. So this A divided by B will give you work done per second, weight of the water striking per second. That is work done per unit weight. That is nothing but what you will get now. A is nothing but A is nothing but what you are having, rho q vw2 u2, vw2 u2 you are having, whereas this one is rho q g you are having, rho q will get cancelled, you will be getting vw2 u2 by g. Work done per second per unit weight is equal to vw2 u2 by g, okay. So, this is being assumed by taking inlet as radial. That is very important. When the inlet is radial, that means the flow is radial. That's what the discussion we have taken. The flow is radial. That is the first assumption that we have made now. assumption the flow is in radial direction. That means VW1 is equal to 0. This is what the first assumption. But in case if you take VW1 also into account, you will get, just see it here now, VW2 U2 is there now by G work done per second. I am saying VW2 U2 by G minus of VW1 U1 by G, it will become for total weight W. For total per unit weight we have taken, for complete water flow, if you take the total weight also into account, it will become W by G into VW2 U2 minus of VW. This is the general equation now. So work done per second per unit weight. Once again, if W is equal to 1, if W is equal to W, this is the equation. W is equal to 1, it will become 1 over G into VW2 U2 minus of VW1 U1. This equation is called as Euler's momentum equation. This equation is called as the Euler's momentum equation for centrifugal pump. The term 1 by G, this term is also referred as Euler's head, or it is also called as the theoretical head. 1 over G into VW2 U2 minus of VW1 U1 is called as the work done per second. That is called as the theoretical head. Okay, so that should be known to you before going to the next slides, because we will be discussing, we will be using this equation in the next slides. That we will look into it now. So that is about the expression for work done. This is called the Euler's momentum equation, 1 over G into VW2 U2 minus VW1 U1, and is also called as the Euler's head or theoretical head now. Now, the value of W, weight of the liquid is equal to what? So, rho AV into G, that you know it. AV is nothing but the total volume into G, that is nothing but W into Q you will get, because rho by G is equal to W, that is the weight, that is the specific weight. Rho by G is equal to W. If you say W into Q is called as the weight of the liquid. What is Q? Q is nothing but pi D1B1 into V of 1, or it is equal to pi D2B2 into V of 1. What is B here now? This is the B, the width at the exit if you are taking. If you are taking at the inlet, it may be that is the B. This is the closed impeller I have shown. This is the B now. So D is the diameter, you know it now. So pi into D into B will give you the quantity of water it is coming with the velocity area. So pi into D into B will give you the area of flow. Whereas V will give you the, Vf will give you the velocity of flow. So pi into D into B into Vf will give you the volume of liquid that is flowing per second now. So B1 and B2 are called as the widths at the impeller at inlet and outlet. Vf1 and Vf2 are called as the velocity of flow at inlet or exit. This is the exit what I am showing you now. You have already discussed about the closed impeller. This is the shape of the closed impeller I am showing now. So this is the B1, and D1 is nothing but the total diameter, that is D2. If you are taking exit, it is cutting D2. Pi D2 into B2 will give you the area into Vf2 will give you the velocity of flow now. From the equation, it shall be noted that for delivering the liquid to very high height, what is this equation you will get now? If you want higher head, this should be higher. This should be greater now. Because if as VW1 becomes 0, then this is the only responsible now for creating the Euler's maximum head now. So that means if U2 is to become high, what is U2? U2 is equal to pi D2N, pi D2N by 60. That's what we are know it. U2 is equal to pi D2N by 60 now. So if U2 has to become more, the diameter of the impeller should become known now. That should be known to you now. Okay. It shall be noted that for delivering high heads, the peripheral velocity u2 must be high and the vector vw2 must be large. So that is possible, provided if you assume that vw1 is equal to 0, that is the flow is radial. The flow is radial now. So if the flow is radial, vw2 should be high. For making vw2 high, u2 should be large now. To increase u2, what you should have now? The dt should be large. The d2 should be large now. For increasing the impeller diameter, by increasing the impeller diameter and the speed of rotation, u2 can be obtained by increasing the impeller diameter. Increase in the u2 can be obtained by increasing the impeller diameter and speed of rotation. The speed of the rotation can be increased by selecting a proper prime mover, that is the electric prime mover, electric shaft, that is electric motor will be there, that makes our impeller to rotate. That we know it now. It is coupled to the centrifugal pump. The shaft will be there here now. The shaft will be there. So the electric motor rotates this shaft now. It should be at larger diameter, number one. It should be of larger speed. Electric motor should be there. That is the prime mover. As well as, if this diameter becomes small, if this diameter becomes small, then VW2 will become, then this quantity will become more. VW2, U2 will become more, and the work done per second will be more. That means the higher head is possible. Higher head is possible to drive by the centrifugal pump. Okay. The velocity of the component VW2, however, can be augmented by providing adequate number of vanes also. That is also another condition. Adequate number of vanes of suitable size and suitable shape, if you select, that VW2 can also be increased because of the condition that the flow is radial. If the flow becomes radial, then the one is the flow should be radial for maximum efficiency. The flow should be radial because VW1 will become zero in that condition. Number two, proper selection of the impeller size, shape and other thing. Number two. Number three is the diameter of the impeller should be made large, and the speed of the impeller should be made large by means of selecting the prime mover. So with these things, I can increase the head that can be raised by the centrifugal pump. That should be understood at the end of this derivation now. Now, coming to the external velocity triangle, we want to study this one now, and we want to get one more expression here now. So from this expression, what we are having now, VR2 square is equal to Q2 minus of VW2 square, this one, this square, plus of VF2 square. This is what we have seen now. So what is VF2 square from this equation? VF2 square is equal to VR2 square minus of U2 square, U2 minus VW2 whole square. This is the first expression now. So what you will get VF2 square? VF, also VF2 square from this triangle. From the triangle 2, what you are having? VF2 square is equal to VW2 square, V2 square minus of VW2 square, you will get. VF2 square is equal to V2 square minus of VW2 square, you will say. Substitute here in this equation, V2 square minus VW2 square is equal to VR2 square minus of U2 minus of VW2 square, you will get this equation. So expand this, you will get U2 square plus VW2 square minus 2U2 VW2. So simplify this, what you will get now? VR2 square minus U2 square minus VW2 square plus 2U2 VW2, that you will get now. So what is U2 VW2 from this expression? U2 VW2 is equal to half of V2 square minus of plus of U, this will go this side now, V2 square plus U2 square plus U2 square minus of BR2 square minus of VR2 square. That's what you will get now. Similarly, from the inlet triangle, if it is not radial, this is important, if not radial, you will get U1 VW1 is equal to V1 square plus U1 square minus VR1 square. So if not radial, if it is radial, then VW1 itself will become zero. That we know it now. Then this condition will not come into picture. If the flow is not radial, then this equation will come into picture. If it is radial, U into VW1 will become zero. Now you substitute back in this equation, What is this? What is this work done? 1 over g into VW2 U2 minus of VW1 U1. What is VW2 U2? This one. Half into V2 square plus U2 square minus of eta 2 square. U1 VW1, this one now. So just substitute in this equation. Equation 2. Okay. So this is the equation 2 that we are having now. Substitute in this equation 3. So what is this equation we have to substitute? This equation you will get. If you substitute that in this equation, you will get work done is equal to V2 square minus V1 square by 2G minus of U2 square minus U1 square by 2G minus VR1 square minus VR2 square by 2G. Just it is simple, you can see now. There will be this minus of this you will get now. Here only I will say V2 square minus of V1 square by 2G. 1 by G is there now. 1 by G is there here now. 1 by G is there here now. That you take it now. 1 by G is there now. So 1 by G I am taking it outside now. If I take 1 by G outside. So 1 over 2G is there now. V2 square minus of V1 square by 2G. Minus of plus of U2 square minus of U1 square by 2G minus of V1 square minus VR2 square divided by 2G, that you will get now. This equation you will get now. Okay, simple. There is nothing much simplification is there now. So what is this V2 square minus V1 square by 2G? It is nothing but the absolute velocity. V2 and V1 are the absolute velocity. So it is called as the increase in the kinetic energy or the dynamic head. It is also called as the dynamic head. So the absolute velocity variation, V2 square by 2G, that is the velocity head. All these things are the velocity heads now. V square by 2G are nothing but the velocity head, that we know it now. So it is the kinetic and all these things are the terms of change in the kinetic energy only. But this is due to the absolute velocity, that is called as the dynamic head. That is called as the dynamic head now. Increase in the kinetic energy, it is called as the dynamic head now. U2 square minus U1 square by 2G, it is because of the rotation of the impeller now. It is called as the static pressure. It is called as the dynamic head. It is also called as the static head or static pressure. U2 square minus of U1 square by 2G. VR1 square minus VR2 square by 2G is nothing but what? Relative velocity. Change in the rate of change of relative velocity. So this is called as the retardation of the relative velocity to the impeller. The third term indicates the change in the kinetic energy due to retardation in the flow in the relative velocity of the impeller. Relative velocity in the impeller. That should be there. We have already assumed that there is no loss now. This term therefore represents the conversion of kinetic energy within the impeller itself. So this kinetic energy is developed within the impeller. This is due to the rotation. This is due to the velocity. This is called as the dynamic head. This is due to the static pressure, static head. This is due to the conversion within the impeller. So this is called as the fundamental equation of the centrifugal pump. This equation is called as the fundamental equation of the centrifugal pump. In all these things you can say V2, V1 is there, U2, U1 is there, but here VR1, VR2 is there. VR1 first is there, that you should know. Otherwise, as after passing through the inlet, it is coming out. Therefore, VR1 will be written for inlet, and VR2 will be written for outlet. VR1 is always greater than VR2. That should be known to you. Therefore, the equation is VR1 minus VR2 square, VR1 square minus VR2 square by 2G is coming into picture. That should be. One is called as the dynamic head. The second one is called as the static head. The third one is called as the conversion of kinetic energy within the impeller only. This is called the fundamental equation of the centrifugal pump. They may ask you in your examination to derive the fundamental equation of the centrifugal pump also now. Okay. So there we discussed on how the work done can be obtained from a centrifugal pump now. So now next we shall go for a next topic, that is called as head of a pump. How do you define the head of a pump now? So head of a centrifugal pump may be expressed in three ways now. One is called as the static head, second one is called as the manometric head, the third one is called the total head or gross head or effective head. Everything is one and the same now. So what is static head? So static head, we know it now. Static head is nothing but it is the sum of the suction head and the delivery head. So we know that this is, if you see three this figure, the water is to be raised from this level. Water is to be raised from the sump to the overhead tank. So this head is called as the total head. This is called as the total head. HS plus HD is called as the total head now. Okay. Suction head plus delivery head now. So now, here, just look into here now. Suction head is the vertical height from the center line of the pump shaft above the liquid surface of the sump, being sump to which the liquid is being raised now. This is called as the suction head to the center of the pump. From the water level, from the static water level, this is called as the suction head. Suction head, it is the vertical height of the center line of the pump shaft above the liquid surface in the sump from which the liquid is being raised. That is properly should be understood. It is from the center of the pump shaft. This is the level now. From here to here is called as the suction head now. So what is delivery head? Clearly you just note it to here now. Delivery head, it is the vertical height of the liquid surface in the tank. It is the vertical height of the liquid surface in the tank of the reservoir to which the liquid is delivered above the center of the pump shaft. That should be known to you now. HS plus HD is called as the static head now. So this is the static head now. This is the delivery head now. This one is called as the delivery head now. Okay. So from this level to this level is called as the delivery head. So what is being called now? Diversion, delivery head is the vertical height of the liquid surface in the tank or the reservoir. Liquid surface in the tank or the reservoir. From here, in the tank or the reservoir. Okay, read properly, to which the liquid is delivered above the center of the shaft, above the center of the shaft from here. Okay, right. So that is called as the delivery head now. The term HS and HD are also called the static suction lift or delivery lift, static delivery lift now. static suction lift or static delivery lift. Generally, we call it a static head and delivery head only, or it is also called the suction head and delivery head only. Okay. Now, the next one is monometric head now. So now, the total head that is to be negotiated is nothing but from here to here, we have to actually pump. From the water is to be lifted from this level to this level. This level. So if you design, for example, if this height is say 15 meter, if I design a pump for 15 meter, whether the flow is going to take place from this point to this point, from this point to this point. No, it is not possible, because there will be several losses that are going to take place in the suction pipe as well as in the pump as well as in the delivery. All these losses ought to be taken care of now. So these losses, if they are say equal to 2 meter, then I have to design for 17 meter, not for 15 meter. So the losses ought to be taken. So therefore, the definition, that means the total head to be negotiated, if you design from the level in the sump to the level in the tank, will not suffice. You have to understand what is the losses in the pump that is going to happen. Therefore, we have defined one more head that is called as the monometric head. Monometric head is the actual total head that could be achieved from the pump now. Actual total head that can be achieved from the pump. So it is not 15 meter it will take. If you pump, if you design actually for 15 meter, it will not deliver to 15 meter, it will deliver to 14 meter only. That means it will reduce by 1 meter, it cannot lift for 1 meter. So it is this actual head, this is the actual head. Actual head that could be achieved from the pump is called as the monometric head. It is smaller than the Euler's head. What is Euler's head? We have already defined what is Euler's head. Euler's head is nothing but 1 over g into Vw2 u2 minus of Vw1 u1. This is called as the Euler's head, or it is also called as v2 square minus v1 square by 2g minus of u2 square minus u1 square by 2g minus of vr1 square minus vr2 square by 2g. So these are called as the Euler's equation. 1 over g into Vw2 u2 minus Vw1 u1. This is called as the Euler's set now. So this cannot be achieved. It is smaller than the Euler's set. That is the total head that can be negotiated by an amount equal to HFI. It is called as the energy loss. What are the losses? We will discuss it separately. However, I have written a small losses that are going to happen. Hydraulic losses, that include the frictional losses in the plate passage, circulatory flow losses, what is this I will tell you, between the blades due to the finite number of blades in the impeller, and shock losses at the entrance and exit. These losses, what you assumed in the derivation, in the assumption, it is equal to zero. It is not there. That's what we have discussed in the assumption. This is what we have made assumption in the beginning. The losses are zero. The losses are zero that we have taken. Therefore, we have got an equation 1 over g into Vw2 u2 minus of Vw1 u1. So this is called as the Euler's head or total head. Assuming that these losses are zero. But truly, these losses will not be there. These losses will be there whenever a pump is being installed now. These losses ought to be taken. So the hydraulic losses, the shock losses, the circulatory losses, all these losses ought to be taken. It happens in between the impeller. It happens at the entrance and exit of the impeller. And some losses are going to happen in between the blade passes. All these losses ought to be taken into account. Therefore, actual head that is equal to HM. This is the actual head that the pump can negotiate. That is nothing but HE minus of HFI. This HFI is nothing but the losses. HFI is nothing but losses. This we called it as 1 meter. It will only lift 14 meter. It will not lift 15 meter. This 1 meter is a loss. So these losses ought to be taken. Otherwise, pump cannot deliver to the design head what is being discussed by means of this formula now. Okay. So now let us go for a small derivation, how to get monometric efficiency, monometric head. Now, you consider this figure now. So, the, here this is PA, atmospheric pressure now, and this is P2, this is P2, and this is P3, that is the entrance and the exit of the pump, and this is P4, that is the pressure at 4 now. So, here if I apply the Bernoulli's equation between the point 1, this is point 1 and point 4, point 1 and point 4. Point 1 is having atmospheric pressure, PA by W. I have taken that as the data. Here there is no velocity head, that is 0. Here there is no datum head, it's 0. And you are having the, this is the monometric head, total monometric head. This should be equal to, this should be equal to P4 by W plus V2 square or VD square, here VD square by 2G plus Z2, that is but H-stat plus HS plus HD, HS plus HD, that is the total head that has to take, and I have to take the value of HFI is to be taken. So that's what we have written the equation. Just look into here now. PA by W plus HF is equal to PA by W plus HS plus HT. This is Z now. HFS plus HFT. This is the HFS plus HFD is nothing but total loss I have taken. Friction loss including minor loss in suction pipe. Friction loss including minor loss in delivery pipe. I have written separately, but you can write HFY plus VD square by 2G. That's what I have written. HFI I have written now. HFI comprise of, HFI comprise of HFS, that is the suction, the friction loss in suction pipe. HFD is nothing but the friction loss in delivery pipe. So PA P4 by W plus VD square by 2G plus HFS plus HFD plus HFS plus HFT. That's what we have written now. Just look into it now. So this is what we have written. VD square by 2G is written now. Okay. So now, from this I can get an expression here. PA by W will get cancelled now. So I will get an expression. HF is equal to HS plus HD. This is the this one now. HFS plus HFD. Okay. HFS plus HFD, this is called as the total, this one, this is called as the static head, this is called as the losses. This HM I have called now. So, VD square by 2G, that will be there now. So, this VD is equal to, if VD is equal to VS, that is nothing but the velocity in the delivery pipe is equal to velocity in the suction pipe, it is not much is there, then that will become 0 now. Then you will get P2, this head, HM is equal to, this is the equation that you will get, HM is equal to HS plus HD plus HFS plus HD or HTAS plus this one now. So what is HM now? HM is equal to, just look into the previous figure, HM is equal to P3 by W minus of P 2 by W, that is the pump loss, the loss in the pump, that is nothing but P3 by W minus of P2 by W. If you call that P3 by W, P2 by W, that is nothing but the HM, that is called the monometric head. Okay. So this can also be obtained as total losses, that is total head plus losses. This is the head, that is actual head that is negotiated. This can also be obtained P3 by W minus P2 by W is equal to HF. So, this equation is a very simple equation, shall be known to you now. Applying the Pythagoras equation, it is easy for you to get the monometric head. Using this equation, only in the pump if you want to do, this is the HM, that is called the P3 by W minus P2 by W is to be calculated. This is the total head that is to be negotiated. P3 by W minus P2 by W is nothing but it is the pump has to negotiate. This P3 by W minus P2 by W is equal to, this is the thing, the difference between P3 by W minus P2 by W should be equal to HS plus HD plus HFS plus HD, or H static, this we call it as H static plus losses. Okay, so these losses, if there are some more losses, are also to be taken. That we will look into it in the next class, this next slides. Okay, however, here we have taken the loss in the friction, loss in the suction pipe, and loss in the delivery pipe. P3 by W minus P2 by W will take you the loss in the impeller as well as loss in the casing also will be taken into account in when you do P3 by W minus P2 by W. So total difference, what is the head that is at that the pump has to deliver, is nothing but P3 by W minus P2 by W only. So this, what is the loss? So for example, 15 meter I want to design means, so the difference between these two, the difference in the pressure rate between these two points, what is the pressure rate? That should be equal to 15 meter. Whatsoever it may be, it may take place here or it may take place. So if all these losses are taken into account, this 15 meter, that is the loss that has happened here, plus what is the loss that is happening in suction pipe and delivery pipe is to be taken. So that 15 plus loss in the suction pipe plus loss in the delivery pipe will deliver the head that the actual head the pump has to deliver now. Okay, so therefore monometric head is nothing but it is the actual total head that could be achieved from the pump now. That could be achieved from the pump, that is nothing but P3 by W minus P2 by W. It is smaller than the Euler's head now. What is that it can be negotiated now? What is the pump can negotiate? The pump can negotiate only P3 by W minus P2 by W. This is that. This is equal to what? How much head the pump can deliver? What is the pump can deliver means what? This is P3 by W minus P2 by W. That is nothing but HS plus HD plus HFS plus HD. That is static head plus the losses it can take. Okay. So this difference, this P3 by W minus P2 by W shall be equal to this much, then only it is possible for us to see that the pump will deliver to the required height. Okay, that should be properly understood here now. So what is next is total gross or effective head. It is equal to static head plus the head losses occurring in the flow before and through and after the impeller. Everything, flow before, through, as well as after the impeller. So all these things will come into. What is this, the total head? Total head is equal to static head plus the losses that happens in the suction pipe, loss that happen in the impeller before, through, and after the impeller. That should be equal. It is equal to static head, that is HS plus HD, plus what is the loss that is going to happen in the pump losses. That will become the total head. Okay. So HS plus HD, HS plus HD plus HFS will come into picture. The friction loss in the pipe and the delivery pipe now. All these things will come into picture. HS plus HD plus the loss that has happened in the suction pipe, the loss that happened in the delivery pipe, plus the pump loss. This is nothing but the total head. The total head that or the gross head or the effective head. It is equal to static head plus all head losses occurring in flow before, through and after the impeller. So this is the general equation for the total head. Okay. So now we shall go to the next topic. What are the losses that are going to happen now? So what are the losses? The losses can be classified into hydraulic loss, mechanical loss and leakage loss. So now, so just look into this figure now. The electric shaft, that the prime mover is directing the impeller to rotate. The shaft is going to be rotated from the prime mover. There will be loss in the shaft only. Because of the friction loss. They are called the mechanical losses now. So the impeller power is equal to WQ VW1 U1 by G now. Okay. So this is the electrical power. Electrical motor power. Or in general, I call it as, it is called as the prime mover power. So it is rotating the shaft now. There will be certain losses when it is transferring from the shaft of the electrical motor to the impeller. This loss is called the mechanical loss. VW1 U1 by G, that you know it already now. VW1 U1 by G at the entry of the impeller, what is happening now? This is VW1 talks of the entry of the impeller, that is the horizontal component of the VW1. U1 is called as the rotation component of the tangential velocity component of the internal radius. So that will give you the impeller power now. So at that shaft, at the shaft level now. Okay. Now, hydraulic losses are going to take place because of the various losses, what we have discussed, what we will be discussing in the next slide now. Maybe in the impeller, shock loss may be happen. The entry exit may loss happen now. You may have the loss due to the pressure difference, circulatory loss is going to happen now. As well as the casing loss is going to happen now. And also, you may have the loss in the delivery pipe as well as the suction pipe. All these losses are called as the hydraulic losses now. So this is the manometric head, that is the actual head that can be transferred, that I already discussed. This is the actual head. HM is called an actual head, the pump can transfer, which takes care of all the losses into account. Okay, all the losses, it has to take care. If you have to take the suction loss as well as the suction pipe, but only for pump if you are taking. Just for the pump you are taking, you may have to remove suction pipe loss as well as delivery pipe loss. What is the loss that is going to happen inside only is to be considered. That is called as the, that difference is called as the manometric head. If you are taking only the pump into account, okay, that is called as the manometric head, because I am talking only about the pump now. If you take the suction pipe as well as the delivery pipe, how much it is to be negotiated, then for the pump design it will come. That is also for the design, what is the manometric head is to be, if you want to consider that, that will come into picture now. So WQH mono divided by 1000 will give you the output power now. What is the other static class, other hydraulic classes means, that's what the suction pipe as well as the delivery pipe, if you take, then it is called as the WQHS divided by 1000 will give you the other hydraulic loss. If you take, this is called the static power loss now. Okay, here it is only taking P3 by W minus of P2 by W. That is called as here HF. In this case, here you are taking HFS as well as HFD is also being taken. That is the last that is happening in the suction pipe as well as delivery pipe is being taken into account. Okay. So now, hydraulic losses are the losses occurred in the fluid flowing in the pump now. The losses can be classified into, I am only concentrating only on the pump. Nothing, I am not considering the delivery pipe. I am not considering the suction side. I am not considering. I am only considering the pump here now. Okay. Circulatory flow loss, fluid friction loss, shock loss or eddy loss. These are the three losses that are going to happen now. What is circulatory loss now? Due to the flow taking place between the pump now. So here there are vanes now. This is called as the leading vane. Leading blade. This is called as the trailing vane now. This is called as the leading blade and this is called as the trailing blade now. So here, what will happen? Here you will be having the higher edge. As the water flows here now, you will be having higher pressure here and the lower pressure here now. Adjacent side of the this one now. So high pressure is formed along the leading edge of the vane. High pressure happens at the leading edge of the vane. And in the trailing edge of the blade, relatively low pressure is formed. On the trailing head, you will be having relatively low pressure. That is being shown by negative line here now. The presence of finite number of vanes, that means number of vanes are finite here. Finite means countable. Finite number of vanes. A finite thickness. Thickness is also finite. The actual velocity triangle. What you draw VW1 at the exit now. You are drawing the velocity triangle at the exit now. So when you draw velocity triangle at any time, the velocity triangle should be always parallel to the what is the ideal what we are drawn. This is the ideal velocity triangle that is happening. This is VF1, this is U1, what we have discussed now. This is V2 and this is VR2. We discussed this one. This is VW2, this is what? This is what we have discussed. So always when the flow happens, this is the ideal velocity triangle means the velocity triangle should follow this one only. Or it should be parallel to this only. Or it should be similar to this only. If it will not happen whenever there is a flow which is greater than the design flow. Or it is lesser than the design flow. It is not possible to flow. So sometime we will run the centrifugal pump at a greater speed than the design speed or at a lesser speed than the design speed. If it happens like that, then it will not be parallel to each now. Because of that, there is certain difference in heads that is going to happen, and this difference is called as a circulatory flow loss now. So the presence of finite number of vanes and finite thickness causes actual velocity triangle at the exit of the impeller to be different from the ideal one with less value of tangential velocity component than the ideal impeller. Tangential velocity component means this is U2 will be less or U2 will be more now. Okay. It is less of the tangential from the ideal. The actual head developed is smaller than the ideal ulnar head. So what will happen? VW2, U2. This U2 becomes less means naturally there is a certain loss. Okay. Smaller than the ideal. The difference in these two Wirrle component, Wirrle velocities, that is VW2. VW2 will also be less as well as the U2 component will also be less now. This difference in VW2 velocities causes what is known as slip. That is called as the slip now. Okay. So the difference in these two whirl velocities is called as slip of the impeller. The difference in the head T is taken as the loss in the impeller due to circulatory flow. Therefore, because the velocity triangle will not be similar to the ideal flow what we were designed or what is being designed, if at all, if it is less or more than the speed at which the impeller is running or the discharge is flowing, then you will be having a difference in the value of U2 as well as VW2. So that slip, the velocity of the whirl is going to change. VW2 will not be equal to VW2, which is less. That is called as the slip. That is nothing but VW2 is not equal to VW2. It will be VW2 will be less than the VW2 what is being designed. That is called as the slip now. Because of this slip, there is difference in the head. And this head, because of this head, what will happen now? What we have already known, 1 over G into VW2 U2. This is what we are saying. The actual design is so much, but it will be flowing VW2 dash into U2. Maybe flowing now. This difference of VW2 and VW2 dash, because of that, there will be certain loss of flow that is called as the slip, that is also called as the circulatory flow. Why it happens now? Why it happens? Higher pressure on the leading edge and lower pressure on the trailing edge is going to happen because of the design of the blades, because of the design of the blades due to the flow that is taking place between the two adjacent vanes. And because of that, this finite number of vanes that are there and the thickness of the vanes that are there, because of that, there will be certain amount of loss is going to happen. The velocity of the whirl, what is being designed, will not be equal to the velocity of the whirl, what is actually measured. This difference is called as the slip. Because of this slip, there will be loss. Those loss is called as the circulatory flow loss. Because of that, what will happen? The flow will be equal to 1 by G into VW2 dash into U2, which is less than 1 over G into VW2 U2. That is the work done. Work done will become less means because of that, the loss is going to happen. That is called as the circulatory loss now. Now the fluid friction loss that happens between the flow passages now. The loss depends upon the area of contact with the fluid flow and the roughness and the magnitude of the surface. Now, the loss can be considered to vary as the square of the velocity. The friction is caused by the fluid changing in the direction when it is traveling through the pump and the clearance within the pump. These losses vary from both head now. So what will happen? The flow is passing through the volute chamber now. That is, the change in the direction is going to happen now. As it is flowing, it is touching the casing also now. As this is flowing, the water is flowing, it is touching casing also. There is a friction between the surface, between the casing, as well as here also, the blade friction will be there now. So these losses are called as the fluid friction loss. This loss depends upon the area of contact, how much of area it is in contact, okay, and the roughness, what material this casing is made of now. The loss can be considered to vary as the square of the velocity. The friction is caused by fluid changing the direction when traveling through the pump and the clearance, by the clearance within the pump now. Okay. Now the next one is shock loss now. The loss occurs due to improper entry angle of the flow with respect to the blade angle. We have designed for certain blade angle, but if it is not properly happening now, then the improper entry, if it is not properly designed, the water entry will not be from the impeller towards the blade will not be proper, and hence loss is going to happen. So at design condition, this loss is practically zero. at design condition, this loss is practically zero. That should be known to you now. Because in design, we will design certain angle now. But when there is reduction or increase in the normal discharge, when there is reduction in the increase, reduction or increase in the normal discharge, we have designed for certain Q. If Q1 is greater than Q, or if Q1 is less than Q, then what will happen? Where the discharge is reduced or increased from the normal value while it runs at the same speed. The rotation, the move, the rotor will be moving, that is nothing but the shaft is rotating at the same speed. The shaft is designed for 1000 RPM means it is designed, it is rotating at 1000 RPM only. But the discharge that is we want is less or it is more. Because of that, we have operated the delivery valve. If we operate like this, the entry will not be proper. The entry will not be proper. The entry of water into the blade will not be proper, and there will be certain shock that is going to happen. The new relative velocity is not parallel to the tangent at its tip in respect to normal design discharge. Hence, there is a mismatch. This result will cause the shock in entrance. That's what. The relative velocity will not be parallel to the original velocity triangle, and hence there will be a mismatch, there will be a shock. The shock loss is going to take place. This type of loss is called as the shock loss now. So non-hydraulic loss in this is because some leakage that may happen. So this leakage may happen because the gasket or the things. So leakage of thrust because of the gland or filling or the clearance between the cut water casing and bearing seals. Seals are not properly done, or gland sealings are not properly done. They are called as the external leakage loss now. External leakage now. Now internal leakage loss due to improper clearance between the casing and the impeller. Due to improper clearance between the, this is the casing and the impeller, the water will leak from here now. The water will leak between the impeller and the casing. Due to improper clearance between the impeller and the casing, some water after receiving energy at the impeller may not exit. It may not flow to the spiral casing. It may leak out here only. Before entering into exit, it may leak out here only. So may not reach the exit from the pump outlet. A part of it may leak out of the casing to the waste. It may become the waste. This is called as the internal leakage loss. The other one, external leakage loss, it is not properly sealed. It is because of gland sealing or clearances between the cut water or casing or bearing seals. These seals or gland sealings is not properly being done. Means then also leakage loss is going to happen. So non-hydraulic losses are the losses which occur in the mechanical components of the centrifugal pump. This is the mechanical components. It is no way concerned with our design. Okay. It is because of not properly fabricated, not properly sealed. Okay. They are called as the non-hydraulic losses now. So these are the various losses now. Now the next one is the mechanical loss now. So mechanical losses are the loss due to friction between the impeller and liquid which fills the clearance. This is the mechanical loss. Impeller and liquid which fills the clearance space between the impeller and casing. Okay, this one. Friction. It is the loss between the disc friction. It is the loss between the loss due to disc friction between impeller and liquid which fills the clearance. Okay, these are also the losses due to mechanical friction in bearing, packing glands and other contact points. Now this is also mechanical loss only. So this also comes under mechanical loss only. That should be non-hydraulic loss only now. So properly it should be designed. Properly it should be designed. Otherwise disc friction loss is going to happen. That friction loss is going to happen. The leakage loss are going to happen now if it is not properly fabricated. Okay. So it is between the impeller. This is called as the impeller now and the liquid in between it now. And liquid which fills the clearance between the impeller and casing. This is the casing now. This is the impeller. In between this liquid, here the loss may happen. Here the loss may happen. These losses are called as the mechanical losses. These are also the losses due to mechanical friction in bearing. That is very important. Mechanical friction in bearing, packing glands and other contact points. Okay. So it is bearing loss we call or packing loss we call now. So packing should be properly done, otherwise leakages are going to happen now, or the friction loss is going to happen now. Now the next topic is efficiencies of a centrifugal pump. So we have already discussed about the various losses. According as it, the efficiencies will come into picture. Nothing more now. Efficiency is nothing but the output by input now. In case of centrifugal pump, power is transmitted from the shaft of the electrical motor to the shaft of the pump and then to the impeller. That we know it now. So first is electric motor or prime mover to the shaft of the pump. It will transfer and then to the impeller. The transfer of the power is going to happen like this now. From the impeller, the power is given to the water. That is the process that happens now. Thus, power is decreasing from shaft of the pump to the impeller and then to the water. This is how we have to think it now. First is shaft, next is impeller, next is water. Like that, the efficiencies is being discussed here now. According as it, we can define the efficiencies as monometric efficiency, volumetric efficiency, mechanical efficiencies, and overall efficiency now. What is monometric efficiency? So it is nothing but actual head divided by the actual head, that is imported now. So the ratio of monometric head to the head imported by the impeller to the water is known as the monometric efficiency. Monometric efficiency is nothing but the ratio of the monometric head. What is monometric head? We know it already now. So that is nothing but we have already discussed now. What are the various monometric head? We have already discussed now. Monometric head divided by the head imported by the impeller now. Okay. Now, next one is the power at the impeller of the pump is more than the power given to the water. Power at the impeller of the pump is more than the power given to the water. That should be known to you at the outlet of the pump now. The ratio of the power given to the water at the outlet of the pump to the power available at the impeller is known as the monometric efficiency. Okay. Power given to the water at outlet of the pump. What is this? Power given to the water at the outlet of the pump. That is W into HM. W into HM. 1000 is because of kilo it has come. W into HM is sufficient now. Power given to water at the outlet of the pump now. Okay. So power at the impeller is nothing but what? W by G into VW to U2 by VW to UG or 1 by G into VW to U2. That we know it already now. If you are taking weight W, that is nothing but W by G into VW to U2. So this is nothing but the power at the impeller now. So this is power output. This is power given to the impeller now. WHM divided by W by G into VW to U2 will give you the eta volume. That is WHM, WHM divided by W by G into VW2 U2. That will give you WW will get cancelled. You will get G into HM divided by VW2 into U2. This will give you the monometric efficiency. This will give you the work done by the impeller. This we know it, W by G into VW2 U2. Now, at the beginning of the impeller, at the output, what is this? W into HM. HM is the monometric head. What is this HM? HM consists of all the losses that it has to negotiate. Okay. So now, once again, I will tell you when the time comes. Now, volumetric efficiency, it is the ratio of the quantity of the liquid discharged per second. Ratio of the volumetric, it is the output. What you are getting in the reservoir. Okay. This is nothing but what? What is reservoir? What is your coming in the reservoir plus the losses for which it is being designed. The pump is being designed for this now. So this is because of the losses. It is not reaching. It is designed. This Q is to be designed for losses now. Okay. So because of the losses, this loss, actually it is pumping only so much now. What is the output? What is the input? Output is only Q. What is coming to the reservoir is only Q now. What is the losses that is going to happen is to be taken, that is the input now. What is actually pumping is Q plus Q now. Okay. Q is the leakage of liquid per second from the impeller. What are the leakage losses that I have discussed in the previous section now? Okay. It may be through the external loss, it may be through the internal loss. All these things will come into picture now. So that Q is to be taken into account now. So the ratio of quantity of liquid discharge per second, this is the actual quantity of liquid discharge per second from the pump to the quantity passing per second through the impeller. Actually the impeller has pumped so much, but there is certain loss. This loss is going to happen. That leakage is loss is going to happen because of the glands or because of the external losses, what we have discussed. Because of that, this is actually pumped by the turbine, but this is what we are getting at the reservoir now. Okay, Q divided by Q plus Q, actual water discharge per second at the pump outlet. That means at the delivery pipe. This is the pump means I am considering at this point. This is the pump means this is capital Q. Okay. So what actually it is pumped is Q plus Q divided by Q will give the volumetric efficiency. So the mechanical efficiency, here the electrical motor will come into picture. I have already told you the mechanical losses are going to happen when it is transferring the shaft. The electrical motor is transferring its energy through the shaft to the impeller now. So what is it is the loss, that the power at the impeller, power at the shaft. It may transfer, the electric motor may transfer 1100 rpm, but the impeller is rotating at 1090 rpm. That means 10 rpm less it is rotating because of the bearing loss or the friction loss between the shaft and the impeller now. So power at impeller to the power at the shaft now. Power at impeller is to be calculated for 1100 rpm. Power at the impeller is to be calculated for 1090 rpm. Power at the shaft is to be calculated for 1100 rpm. Okay, 1100 rpm. So the power of the shaft of the centrifugal pump is more than the power available at the impeller of the pump. That is important. So I am transferring from electric motor. There will be a shaft now. Shaft is there. Now it is connected to the pump, electric pump. Our pump is there now. So this is transferring now. This is transferring 1100, but it is accepting only 1090. So there will be certain loss. This loss is called as the mechanical loss. Mechanical loss. So power at the shaft of the centrifugal pump, so at this pump, is more than the power available at the impeller of the pump. Now, the ratio of the power available at the impeller to the power at the shaft of the centrifugal pump is known as the mechanical efficiency. Okay. So it is nothing but what? Power available at the impeller is equal to W by G into, once again, W by G into VW2 U2. This is the power available that you know it now. Divided by shaft power. Okay, what is W? W is equal to small W, that is the, this is the W is nothing but what? Weight. Weight is a specific W into Q divided by G, we say. Weight of water. W is nothing but weight of water. Here, this W is equal to what? That is equal to, this is equal to W into Q. That we have already told now. So here, Q should be equal to total Q that we want to take. That is, the leakage is also to be taken. W into Q plus Q divided by G. This W will become W into small W. That is the specific weight. This is nothing but specific weight into Q plus Q. What is Q here? Leakage loss. This is actual pump divided by G. Into VW2 U2 by G. Now, this is the shaft power. Okay? That this W is nothing but what? Weight of water. That is W by G. Now. Okay? So, like this, I can get the expression for eta M now. What is overall efficiency now? What is overall that we require now? Overall means what? So, I have already told you the electric motor is the electric motor is transferring the power to the centrifugal pump. Now this is transferring the water for the our reservoir from the sump. This is our sump. So what is that? It is nothing but the weight of the water lifted into HM, that is W into HM. Okay, that is the manometric head that is negotiated by the actual head. Actual head negotiated by the centrifugal pump. Actual head negotiated by the centrifugal pump. By centrifugal pump. But actual power, what we have given? Actual power. So what is that? For example, you are assuming that your KEV will charge for electric power you are giving now. If your centrifugal pump is not properly working because of improper design or because of various losses, no maintenance problem, because of that various losses are happening now. So then they are not asking, my centrifugal pump is not working so much. Means they will not ask. You have to give the charge for the shaft power, what it is being given from the electrical power, what you are giving now. So that is nothing but the shaft power. Electrical power, what you are getting is nothing but the shaft power now. Okay. Shaft power, this is the actual power, what is being supplied. So it is nothing but power supplied by the electric motor. It is called as the shaft power of the pump. Power supplied from the electric power of the motor is called as shaft power of the pump. Now that should be known to you. That is the input. The output is nothing but weight of the water lifted. Weight of the water lifted. That is nothing but what? W into HM. Into HM. Weight of the water lifted into HM will give you the actual power that is being taken care of by your centrifugal pump. Actual power that centrifugal pump is working now. That is nothing but W into HM now. Okay. So W into HM is the weight of the water into HM divided by 1000 will give you the actual power the centrifugal pump is utilizing. This is nothing but SP, nothing but the actual electric power we are supplying to the centrifugal pump. If it is not properly maintained, then the efficiency will come down. Therefore, overall efficiency should always be good. We should always maintain the centrifugal pump properly and design it properly. Then we can take the electrical, then we can get higher efficiency. We can get higher efficiency. Overall efficiency looks into how much of energy you have transferred from the electrical motor and how much of output you have got from the centrifugal pump. Now, W into HM, that is weight of the water lifted into HM, that is the total head that is being negotiated, including all losses here. Okay, divided by SP, that is the shaft power. Okay, that is the negative. So there we completed the efficiency now. Now we are looking at minimum starting speed of centrifugal pump. It is a small topic. So this is the monometric head, this we know it now. It has to negotiate this, that is the static head, it has to negotiate now. HD it has to negotiate, that is the delivery head. HFS it has to negotiate, that is the friction loss in the suction pipe, the friction loss in the delivery pipe, and VD squared by 2G. This is one which is not being utilized. It is coming out with this now. Okay, so VD squared by 2G. So this is the total monometric head it has to negotiate. A centrifugal pump has to negotiate. When the centrifugal pump is started, it will start delivering the water only if the pressure rise is greater than HM. If the value of HP, that is the power generated from the pump, is greater than HM, that is the monometric head, what we have discussed here now, then only the water will come to here now. Then only the water will come from sump to the reservoir now. If it is not so, you don't get water at all. You don't get it. So, for example, if you are designed for 15 meter and if your difference in the level is say 16 meter or 18 meter, then it will not this one because there is a design loss. On the other hand, this is the HSHD, this is the suction head, this is the delivery head, this is the losses that are going to happen, this is VD squared by 2G, this is the total monometric head it has to, actual monometric head the pump has to negotiate. If this head is to be negotiated, your electric motor has to transfer a power HP greater than HM. Then only you will be having the water that is coming out of the coming to the reservoir from the sump. Now, when the centrifugal pump is started, it will start delivering water only if the pressure rise in the impeller is more or equal to monometric head now. Okay. If not, what will happen? Even if the water is there, it starts rotating here. It is called as forced vortex. It is called as the forced vortex. If not, pump will not discharge any water through the impeller, even if it is rotating. The pump may rotate with water, but it may not deliver because sufficient head is not there. Generally, when the impeller starts rotating, the water in the contact impeller also starts rotating, which is called as the forced vortex. Now, in case of forced vortex flow, the centrifugal head, due to pressure rise, is nothing but water. You know that U is equal to omega R. So, omega square R square divided by 2G. This is the centrifugal head. Omega 1 square, omega 2 square, R2 square, omega only, omega is constant now. Omega R2 square by 2G, omega square R1 square by 2G. This is the difference in the angular velocity between the inlet and the outlet. But G is so equal to omega R is equal to U2 and omega R1 is equal to U1. U2 square by 2G, these are the tangential velocities at the outlet and tangential velocity at the inlet now. So, this is the force vector. This pressure rise will be u2 square by 2g minus of u1 square by 2g now. So this u2 square by 2g minus u1 square by 2g should be greater than hm, or at least it should be equal to 0. Okay, then only it is possible. This is the basic equation. This is called as the basic equation for minimum flow. Basic equation for minimum speed. But I don't have here speed value now. How to get it? So this is being obtained. We know that eta mono, that is the monometric efficiency, is equal to g into hm divided by vw to u2. We have already derived this equation now. So from this hm is equal to, what you will get now? Eta mono into vw to u2 divided by g will get now. So I can write this one. This u1, u2 square minus u1 square by 2g is equal to this. You can write this what I have written now. V2 u2 square by 2g minus of u1 square by 2g is equal to eta mono into vw to u2 by g I have written now. What is u2? U is equal to pi dn by 60, that we know it. For u1 I have substituted pi d1n, for u2 I have substituted pi d2n now. Then just substitute in this equation pi d2n whole square, pi d1n whole square. Here u2 is there, pi d2n by 60. So u remove pi into n by 60. This will be get cancelled here now. Pi into n by 60. Here pi into n by 60, 1 pi into n by 60. Here pi into n by 60 will be get cancelled. You will be left with here d2 square. You will be left here with d1 square. Okay. So here it will be d2 will be there as it is now. And gg will get cancelled here. Gg will get cancelled. So what you will get now? You are having 1 pi n by 60 will be there. That I have taken. 60 into 2 will become 120. Pi into n into 120 into d2 square minus of d1 square, what it is there now, minus divided by a is equal to eta mono into vw2 into d2 you will get now. Pi into n by 60 is being get cancelled here. Okay. So with this what you will get? N minimum. From this n minimum, how do you get? N minimum is equal to 120 into eta mono into vw2 into d2 divided by pi into d2 square minus of d1 square. This is the equation that you will get for the minimum speed of the centrifugal pump. So with this minimum speed, only if the rotation happens, the electrical motor rotates and the impeller gets the rotation with this minimum speed, then only it is possible. Here eta mono will take care of what? Eta mono will take care of here now. Just take it to your vw2 u2, everything it is taking care of now. So and hm is there now, then only it is possible for us to drive to the design height for which the centrifugal pump is designed now. Okay, so these are the things we have discussed here. What are the things we have discussed now? Today we have discussed about the work done by the centrifugal pump, and we have discussed about the Euler's head, and we have discussed about the losses in the centrifugal pump. We have discussed in the heads in the centrifugal pump, various heads, and we have discussed about the efficiency, various efficiencies, and the minimum speed required for the centrifugal pump to work now. So these are the various aspects we have discussed now. Work done by the centrifugal pump, from which we have discussed the Euler's head is equal to 1 over g into vw2 into u2, if at all if it is radial, otherwise vw1 into u1 will also come into picture. This is per unit weight. If you want for total weight, you have to multiply by w. This is nothing but the work done we have taken. This we have discussed. This is the Euler's equation. The various losses that are circulatory loss as well as We have discussed about the shock loss. We have discussed about the leakage losses, hydraulic losses and non-hydraulic losses. If the glands are not properly sealed, or if it is the leakage between the disc frictions is also being discussed today now. The various efficiencies like manometric efficiency, the overall efficiency, the mechanical efficiency, the volumetric efficiency is being discussed. The various heads we have discussed, the suction head, the delivery head, as well as the heads, manometric head we have discussed now. Okay, so manometric head is necessary to be defined because this is the actual head the centrifugal pump has to negotiate. That's why it is very important to understand what is manometric head now. So with this, we shall stop today. In the next class, we will look into the numerical problems how to solve. Okay, thank you.